I should have mentioned, I forgot, sorry, but especially here, this theorem is due to Furstenberg, this proposition here. So this is rather, today we can say it is rather classical material about the product of fundamentalities, which dates from the early 60s. Okay, so let me summarize what I did in during the last hour. I used some probabilistic black box here that you can forget about, maybe. And I proved the following proposition. If you take a probability measure, an SL2R, and you assume that the sub-semigroup or the subgroup span by the support is Aristides, that necessarily, when you take a large random product, it goes to infinity. This is just what we prove. It's reasonable, that is, when you take randomly elements of SL2R and you make a product, you think that they will grow. Okay. The theorem is that this is actually what happens. And so this is here, in this statement, there is no stationary probability measure. But in the sequel, we will be also interested in stationary probability measures of the projective line. So knowing, and anyway, in the proof of this statement, as you saw, we use the notion of stationary probability measure. And but anyway, if you know this, you can relatively easily deduce that there exists a unique stationary probability measure on the projective line. And how is this probability, stationary probability measure described? So, as I told you, giving a stationary probability measure on some space is equivalent to give a map B maps to UB from the set of sequences B to the space, to the set of probability measures, which satisfies an equivariance property. And then the stationary probability measure is just the average. Okay. And in our case, an important feature is the fact that necessarily this map takes values in the set of Dirac masses. Okay. Just because when you take a very large element of SL2, it has a tendency to contract everything to a point. So this is why, if you have a convergence of this form, as this knob, this is a very large matrix, necessarily what you get here is a Dirac mass. Okay. And maybe before going further, I can give you the main step. So I can go back to the case where my probability measure mu is concentrated on SL2Z, and where I am trying to prove something to have a classification of stationary probability measures on T2, because this is the goal of the lectures. So this is just a parenthesis, just to give you some hope that we will reach something interesting. And here is the step. So the main step of the proof of the theorem of the classification of stationary measures. So not the original proof by Burger, Forman, Strauss, or Moses, but the proof I will give in this lecture. The main step is the following. Assume that mu is a finitely supported probability measure on SL2Z. And that the gamma mu of course is Aristides in SL2 or non-elemental. And assume that mu is a non-atomic mu stationary Borel probability measure on T2. So this is the object we want to study. So now, we know a little more about probability measures on ZL2. We have all this material here. And we know also a little more about stationary measures. We have all this abstract material, this abstract probabilistic results. And the proposition, the result, is that then, for beta almost every B, indeed, the measure nu B, so you have the measure nu B, you have here in my statement now, X is the torus T2. And I start with the stationary measure nu. I have nu B's. I don't know what they look like, but I know one thing, and this will be the end,
nu b is invariant by translations under psi of b. So,
mu is also a probability measure on SL2R. So I apply to mu this property. And depending on b, I have this random line, psi. And this line acts by translations on the torus. And this is a random line, it depends on b. And then I have a random measure, nu b. My claim is that almost surely, this is beta almost everywhere, the translations under this line preserve nu b. Okay, so of course, and you know, if you know that psi of b is irrational, this tells you that nu b is Lebesgue measure. But you know that psi of b is irrational because, again, you know that this probability measure is stationary, and you know that it does not have atoms. Okay, so almost surely this tells you that psi of b is irrational. So psi of b is almost surely rational. So now, knowing this proposition, this is a technical proposition, but the theorem follows immediately, because as psi of b is almost surely irrational, nu b is almost surely Lebesgue, and as nu is the average of the nu b's, nu is Lebesgue. Okay? So, of course, we now have to prove this proposition. And to prove this proposition, there will be two steps. And the first step will be to prove that if nu is non-atomic, nu b is non-atomic. And this is not evident.
Could you say again, why do you know that psi b is not rational?
Because by ergodicity, either psi of b is almost surely rational, either it is almost surely rational. But the set of rational points is countable. And you know that a stationary measure on a countable set is invariant. Okay? So, let me go back to the proof of this proposition. There will be two steps. The first step is to prove that on the torus C2, if you start with a new, which is non-atomic, almost surely, nu b is non-atomic. And this is not evident, because, for example, if your space is not T2, but P1, the projective line, the stationary measure, there is a Nusnik stationary measure, it is non-atomic, but the nu b's are Dirac masses. So you have, of course, there is a difference between here, when you take this b1, bn, this is a very large element of SL2, this acts on the projective line as a contraction. So it has a tendency to take a non-atomic measure and make it a Dirac mass. And here, when you take a very large product, this will look like a very large anosov map of the torus. So this is expensive. So there is no reason when you let it act on some measure menu that it turns out to be a Dirac mass. This is an intuitive reason, but you have to prove it anyway. So there are two steps. First, there is an intermediate step, so I should write it. So this is proposition B, which concludes the proof, and there is proposition A, a same assumption. And then, for beta almost every b in b, nu b is non-atomic. So there are first you prove that it is non-atomic, and then, by some kind of procedure, you have to prove that knowing that it is non-atomic, it is invariant under some translations. There are two steps. Okay, so today I would like to try to finish the proof of this step. And I have to give you a little more material so about product of random matrices, but I have to go a little further, but I wanted to give you, now that I know what psi of b is, I wanted to give you the strategy. Okay. So let us go back again. Let us forget about actions on T2. Let us go back to general properties of random walks on SL2R. And now I know that this random product here goes to infinity, and I want to, so this is not sufficient for me, I want to have a rate of growth. For example, what I propose to have a rate of growth, I mean now a momentum assumption, because I want to prove what I want to prove is the law of the large numbers, and to get law of large numbers, you have to have a momentum assumption. So this is a new proposition, again by Forsterberg. You assume that the integral over g, g is a set 2. Of the logarithm of the norm of g, the mu of g is finite. So this is precisely the first momentum assumption, if you are familiar. Because the norm of g, it is a multiplicative quantity. So if you want to measure the size of an element, you have to use an additive property, quantity, so you take the log. So this is precisely, I'm saying that the first momentum of my measure is finite. Just as in the study of classical random walks on the line. Okay, then there exists some positive number lambda such that beta almost everywhere. This logarithm goes to lambda. And also, so for any psi in P1, beta almost everywhere, you can, instead of looking at the norm, you can look at the way your matrix expands a given vector. I will change order. Of course, this amounts to the same, because you can apply it to the image of the measure by the inverse map. So this, the fact that this goes to infinity tells me also that bn b1 goes to infinity. Okay. Because I can take inverses and apply the result to the inverse measure. And the norm of the map is the norm of the inverse. And now I prefer to write it in this sense.
Excuse me, I'm completely lost by this.
Sorry.
Position of Forsterberg.
Which one?
You assume that the one on the top of this blackboard. You wrote in the corner that mu is finitely supported for probability measure.
No. This is just for that, this is the assumptions for the study of stationary measures on T2. And now I'm working in a more general framework, which is the case of any probability measure on SL2. So this theorem has no assumption. This proposition has no assumption, just any probability measure on SL2. Okay, this is just to tell you where I want to go.
Okay.
And here, it is just a general property of every probability measure on SL2. And here, it will be a property of every probability measure on SL2 with the finite first momentum.
Okay.
So this, it was just to tell you where we were going. But for the moment, there is no assumptions. We are not the probability measure is not an SL2Z, it is an SL2R, etc. Mm-hmm. Of course, I will apply these results to my probability measure. But for the moment, I don't make any assumptions.
Is B the same as psi?
Excuse me?
Is B the same as psi?
And V is a non-zero element of psi. Okay, this is a... Maybe I should write... Sorry, you're right. This is not... A little stupid. You're right, thank you. For any V in R2, V difference from 0. Think you prefer that? I understand you. Okay, so you can either you can evaluate the norm, or you can evaluate the way the matrix expands the vector, it is not very different. Okay, and finally, and this will be a key property, that is, when I look uniformly for V in V, which is a non-zero vector in R2, when I look at this quantity here, that I take its average over V, this goes to lambda. So the three settings are, they say more or less the same, but So the key point here, let me go back. So forget about the two other settings, and let us go back to this one. The fact that there exists such a lambda just comes from arbitrary abstract reasons in ergodic theory. This is Kingman's subadditive ergodic theorem. Here, you have the sequence of function, which is subadditive, that is just by subadditive of the norm. So the fact that there is a limit, it just comes from an ergodic theorem, which is a subadditive analog of Birkhoff's ergodic theorem. But by the way, historically, this Kingman's ergodic theorem comes after this result. And this result is in fact a motivation for Kingman's ergodic theorem. But today you can forget about it, say that you know Kingman's ergodic theorem, and that it implies the convergence. But the key point here, which is not does not come from a general result, is that the fact that lambda is positive. The fact that there exists such a lambda is natural. And the key point, the key point in this proposition is not the existence of lambda. It's the fact that it is positive. Okay? And now the fact that you can either compute the lambda this way or compute it by applying the matrix to a vector, it's just a general feature about large element of SL2. When you have a large element of SL2, you can compute its norm. Its norm is very close to the norm you get by expanding a given vector. Except when your vector is at the very wrong place in the Cartan decomposition. But this does not happen for beta almost every bit. Just because the stationary measure, the unique stationary measure is non-atomic. So this tells you that for beta almost every bit, so I'm shortening, you have to write it. But just due to the fact that the unique stationary measure for mu change, for the inverse measure, is non-atomic, you know that V almost everywhere falls in the wrong direction for BNB1. So that precisely computing the norm or computing this is the same. And now the only thing, this convergence, the fact that this converges for every V, this is just a dominated convergence theorem. And there is something more, which is the fact that it is uniform in V, and again, this is just small computation about matrices. Not very difficult. Okay, so I will leave it. The only thing I want to prove precisely, and this is the key point, the remainder is just small manipulations about matrices, is the fact that this limit is positive. And this is a very important fact here. And this is a crucial fact that we will use in the sequel. And how do you prove it? In fact, I will prove that for some V, for some of the V's, for almost every V with respect to the stationary measure, that is almost every V, which direction lies in the direction of the stationary measure. You see here, it only depends on the, this is why I first wrote it with a psi. Because it only depends on the direction of V. This is a theorem about P. This is a result about P1. So for almost every psi, with respect to the stationary measure, I will prove that the limit is lambda. So how will I write it? I will consider a dynamical system, a classical one. That is, I will look to V times P1. And I have a map from V times P1 to V times P1. Which takes B psi to TB B1 applied to psi. Okay, so I shift my sequence and I apply the first letter to psi. And this is a map, and let's denote it by T twiddle. And the key point is that when you look at the measure, the product measure beta times nu, where nu is a unique stationary measure on P1, this measure is invariant. And in fact, saying that a measure is stationary, saying that if you have a space X here, and you can define this map as soon as you have a space where the group are, saying that the measure is stationary is exactly saying that the product measure with the Bernoulli measure beta is invariant by this map. This is equivalent. Okay, this is what stationary measures are. And now, on this map, on this space, I have a function. Where phi of b and psi is a logarithm of the norm of B1V over V, where V is a non-zero element of psi. So this time I really need psi. Okay, and just due to this momentum assumption, this function is an L1 function. And here comes the lemma that is known somewhere, sometimes as the Givart lemma. And this is the following. So, now you know, just you look at this quantity. This is exactly the Birkhoff sums of this function. Okay? So you know that this quantity, by Birkhoff's ergodic theorem, converges towards the integral of this function. But now, you want to prove that this integral is a positive number. If what you know is that the Birkhoff sums of psi, not the Birkhoff averages, but the Birkhoff sum go to infinity, just because you have this property here. Tells you that the Birkhoff sums of phi go to infinity. And if the integral is positive, of course the Birkhoff sum go to infinity. But the converse is true.
But there is an inequality, right? It's not equal to the Birkhoff.
Is that equal? But as I told you, this quantity for a fixed v, for beta almost every b, behaves as the norm up to constants which depends on b. So this quantity goes to infinity. I will write it, if you want, I will write it in detail. Okay? But you know that these functions, the Birkhoff sums of this function go to infinity. And it turns out that if you have a function, if its Birkhoff sums go to infinity, the integral is necessarily positive. Okay? So this is a lemma. Assume you have a, I don't know how to write it, eta s. So this is a measure preserving dynamical system. So I mean that this is a space, this is a sigma algebra, this is a probability measure, and this is a map which preserves the probability measure. And assume that you have a function phi which belongs to the L1 space. And that for eta almost every x in E, phi of x plus phi of sx plus phi of snx, the Birkhoff sum, goes to infinity. Then, the integral of phi d eta is positive. So this is an exercise, this is rather tricky. But what I'm saying is that if the integral is negative, the Birkhoff sum go to minus infinity. So they cannot go to they cannot go to infinity. The key point is to understand what happens if the integral is zero. And what we can prove is even more is that if the integral is zero, there is a subsequence of the Birkhoff sum that goes to zero. So exercise. And so this tells me now, let us consider this system. On this system, I have my function phi. And when I compute phi of x, phi of big psi, plus phi of t twiddle big psi, plus phi of t twiddle to the n big psi, let's say minus 1, what I get is exactly the logarithm of bn b1 v over the norm of v for some v different from 0, v in psi. Okay. And now I know that the norm of Bn B1 goes to infinity, almost surely. So this is a matrix, say, Gn. And so when you have, so you have a very large matrix in SL2. So you write it as Dn equals Kn, An, and Ln. Okay, and what I'm saying, this is a simple lemma about SL2, is that for if I have epsilon positive and the vector v in R2, such that for any n sufficiently large, the distance to epsilon positive, there exists some constant, such that for any v in R2, if for n large, the distance between the line spanned by v and the wrong line in the Cartan decomposition is larger than epsilon, then when I compute the norm of GnV over the norm of V, it's larger than 1 over C, norm of Gn. Okay. This is just a general fact about SL2. So, now what happens? So, in fact, this is, I shouldn't put some. I have G in SL2. So this is for any epsilon, there exists some C, such that for any G in SL2, this is just a small computation because. So you have, again, when you have an element of SL2, there is a bad point, which is n minus 1 RE2, and the point where you contract, which is K RE1 on the projective line. And when I am far away from this point, it is easy to compute the norm. This is what I'm saying. And far away means not too close. Okay? So, and in fact, it is very easy to prove this lemma because you can kill L and you can kill K. This, you see, here is, this does not depend on K, so I can kill K. But here, I have, this is an assumption about the position. I can transfer the L here. So you only have to deal with the case where G is A. And this is a very easy computation where G is A. So you can do. So now, what do you know? You want to understand that you have your Gn here. You write Gn as Kn, An, Ln. And you want to be sure that almost surely, when you look at V, the distance from V and Ln minus 1 RE2 remains bounded below. So what you want to prove is that the limit point, V is not a limit point of this sequence. Okay? You follow me still? Maybe it's a little complicated. But what are the limit points of this sequence? This is exactly, Gn is a product of this form, Bn, B1. Okay? So when you look at Gn minus 1, this is B1 minus 1, Bn minus 1. And the Cartan decomposition reads as ln minus 1, an minus 1, kn minus 1. So you want to understand the limit point of this sequence, but this is precisely the psi of b for the reverse measure, for the inverse measure. Okay? So, and you know, since the stationary measure for the inverse, for the image of nu by the inverse map has no atoms, you know that this point has a limit. And this limit is almost never on the line spanned by V. Okay? So for any V, for almost every sequence Bn, you know that this is larger than the logarithm of Bn B1 minus some constant C, which depends on the sequence. So that this goes to infinity. And since this goes to infinity, this function has positive integral. So the limit, here this limit, is positive. And by the same trick, this limit is this limit. Okay? So this limit is positive. Okay, this is a little tricky, but the key point is this lemma here. If you have a Birkhoff sum from this, you can you have an information here, that is that this quantity goes to infinity. This quantity looks like a Birkhoff sum of a function. This Birkhoff sum goes to infinity, hence some integral somewhere must be positive. And this integral is exactly this.
Okay.
So now, I will accomplish a promise. And yesterday, I promised you I would show you there was some good functions appearing in yesterday's talk. This was, so let me remember you. So now we go back. We are done with the product of random matrices and what could be called the Schwarzenberg theory. And we go back to the framework which was there, which I erased, which is the framework of a probability measure on SL2Z. And we look at the action of the torus T2. And now, yesterday, I was concerned by the following question. So I have my probability, I have a point, x, in T2, which is different from 0. And I have my probability measure on SL2Z. And then I pick random elements. So I jump to B1x, jump to B2, B1x, etc. And I wanted to control the average time my random trajectory spent in a neighborhood of 0. And I told you, there is a standard trick to control that, and it is to introduce a nice function. And this was a function u from the torus minus 0 to the set of non-negative numbers, which has the property that when you compute the integral over the G is the same to Z of 2 of GX, that is here it is the sum for G in SL to Z of U of GX mu of G, it is smaller than A U of X. So here, this is a proper map, that is, it goes to infinity when then closer to 0. And this is smaller than some A u of x plus c, where A is smaller than 1, c is some non-negative constant. And I told you yesterday, if there exists such a function, necessarily, so this is, there is an abstract probabilistic result, which tells me that if I have a function of this form, necessarily, a trajectory which starts on another point than 0 cannot spend too much time close to 0, with probability 1. Okay, and I told you, I can build such a function. And the formula is very simple. This is u of x is 1 over the distance from x to 0 to the alpha for some small alpha. In fact, it is not true. I cheated a little. But you will see that I almost didn't cheat. Okay, so anyway, I will construct the function, and the formula might be slightly more complicated. But not that much. And the key point is to use this property here. You see, what this property says is that when you take, you are in R2, and you have a vector, and what it says is that on average, when you take the nth step of your random walk, your vector is highly expanded. Okay, its norm is multiplied by lambda to the n after n step. So it's multiplied by its norm on average it becomes exponential to the n lambda times v. You multiply it by a very large number, and as lambda is positive, you multiply it by a number that is larger than 1. And this A will be the inverse of this number. Because what you say here is that what you want to have, what is it? You have 0. And what does this function? It tells you that here, if you have a point that is close to 0, V, here, X, now what does the random walk do? It expands very quickly the norm of V. Okay, this is its property. So necessarily, if it expands the norm of V by exponential n to the lambda, this function will be multiplied by exponential minus n alpha to the lambda. Do you okay? Are you okay? So this is a proof. No? Do you want a more detailed one? I'm not sure I can write it. Okay, I will give you the complete proof. I understand that you want it. Okay, but anyway, this is the idea. Okay, here, after n step, the random product multiplies my norm by exponential to the n lambda. So that this function here is multiplied by exponential to the minus alpha n lambda, which is smaller than 1, this is what n. Okay, now I will write it precisely. And of course, here, you see, this is why I will need the fact that this property is uniform, which I didn't prove exactly, but which is rather easy to get. This is to have it. I want the number of steps not to depend on the x. I want to fix the number of steps. Okay, let me write it precisely. You have this property. So, in particular, you know that n lambda is positive. Since lambda is positive, so just by, as it is uniform, you know that there exists some n not, such that for any v different from zero in R2, when I look at the integral over B, the logarithm of the norm of Bn, B1v over the norm of B, d beta b, this is larger than n lambda over 2. Okay? And this is the only place I'm cheating. I will consider that n is equal to 1. Else you have to make a small mean at some point, so it's not very difficult. But consider, in the sequence, I will consider that n is 1. Okay? So that what happens, I know that for any v defined from 0, the integral with respect to b of bn of so now n is 1, so the integral over g of the logarithm of the norm of gv over the norm of g d mu of g, which is not an integral, sorry, it is a sum here because my major is discrete, the sum for g in sn to z of the logarithm of the norm of gv over the norm of v, that is the mu of g, is larger than, I have to find a name, theta, which is a positive number. Okay. So now, I want to prove, I will consider the following function. I will consider the function I won't consider a name. Consider the following integral. Say E of alpha. E of alpha is integral. It's the sum for g in SL to z of norm of v over norm of gv to the alpha. So where v is fixed, v different from zero. So this is the function of alpha. And the derivative, so you have to assume that the function, so you assume that there exists some alpha naught, which is a positive number, such that the integral, you can assume so. Say the measure is finitely supported. Now, from now on, the measure nu on SL to z is finitely supported. So, this function is differentiable, since nu of t. Thank you. So, this function is differentiable because it's a finite sum, so there is no problem. And I compute the derivative at alpha equals 0, and what do I get? Precisely this, that is the sum for g of minus mu of g, the logarithm of norm of gv, over norm of g. So this is smaller than minus theta. So I have a function which derivative at 0 is negative. So for small values of alpha, it takes negative values. Smaller values are smaller than one. Okay? And it, of course, now this depends on V. But if you are a little more careful, using the fact that this is true for every V, you can find an alpha that works for every V. Okay? So just by this computation, there exists some alpha. There exists some A, which is smaller than 1, which is the value. Which is the value here at alpha sufficiently close to zero, such that for any v, sorry, I should have denoted by IV of alpha, IV of alpha is smaller than A. You okay? And this precisely now. I will denote a function. I will define a function. What is it? I want to define a function of the torus. So what I do is that my alpha is fixed here. So if what I do is that if f is close enough. So no, excuse me. I define my function by this formula. And what you see is that. When you want to compute, but this is what is it? It is 1 over the norm of V to the alpha, where V is the smallest representative of X in R2. So if V is small enough, when you compute the sum of mu of G, U of GX over U of X, if V is small enough, this is precisely the sum of this form. Because the smallest, since my measure is finitely generated, if V is small enough, the smallest representative for X, the GV is also the smallest representative for GX. So my quotient is just a quotient of this form. So that it's this quantity is smaller than my A.
Can you read out what is written there? E to the
I. This is, sorry.
There's an I above
Ah, this one. Maybe there are this is important line. Okay, this is U of X. What I'm claiming is that I want to prove my inequality here. And so I have to compute a sum of this form. And the sum of this form is precisely when V is small enough, this is just a sum of this form. So that it is smaller than my A. It is here. Okay, so if what I'm saying is that if x is close enough to zero, I have this property. And if x is far away from zero, I have this property. Because I'm far away from zero, everything the function is not too large. Okay? So I have this property. This is just the easy case. When you are far away from zero, it does not matter whatever the function is. Okay, so that I constructed my function. So I hold on to my promise, even if...
So why did you cheat?
No, I cheated because this is just the fact that I assumed that n was 1.
Oh.
So if what I have, in fact, I have this property, but not for the measure, for a convolution power. So this is an exercise that if you have the property for a convolution power, you have to replace. So if you denote this quantity by mu u of x, you have to replace mu u by a function which looks like u of x plus n to the minus 1 over n mu u of x plus a sum of this form, and you get the same inequality of this form. So this is an exercise that if you have a function that works for a convolution power, you have a function that works for the function. But you have, I don't remember the formula. This is why I'm cheating, because I forgot. Okay, but you can assume n equal 1. This does not change that much. Okay. So now,
of
mu,
to get the conclusion.
No, what I'm saying is that if I have a function u, which works for a convolution power here of mu, there is another function u that works for mu. But this is just an abstract trick, but I forgot. There is a formula of this form, but I have been lazy and I didn't check the exact formula, so I cannot write it. And if I try to write it, we will spend the next 20 minutes in computations. Okay, maybe this would be funny, but not for me. Let us go back. So there was two promises, and I have 20 minutes left. I think I can manage. Let's see. So I constructed the function, and now I know this more or less finishes the proof of the fact that of the equidistribution property. This is the fact that I do not spend too much time close to zero using a result that I didn't prove, but it is just an abstract result that does not use anything about the torus, etc. Using again a general probabilistic reason. So now there is another thing I wanted to prove, and this was the proposition I named A. And B, I will use the same trick. I will still use the function U here to prove. And let me write it again.
I think the abstract result is due to Eskin Margulis.
What?
The U trick.
No. No. So the use of this kind of functions in this kind of these problems is of course is due to Eskin and Margulis. The precise formulation I gave is not due to Eskin and Margulis. Okay, so this implies, in fact, what Eskin and Margulis did was to prove the same result but in law. That is, you prove that if you have this property, if you have a group gamma acting with a measure mu acting on a space X, if you have a proper function u from X to 0 infinity, and if you know that there exists that mu u is smaller than au plus c, then you know that any limit point, so u is proper, you know that any limit point of for any x, any limit point of this convolution product, mu to the n delta x, has mass 1, is a probability measure. But I gave an almost sure statement. So this is, so of course, in fact, it's a, I should, you're right on something that I should have mentioned their name, so let me again say that this is someone wonderful that Eskin and Margulis, sorry, introduced. This is the use of this criterion, the fact that on this, in this, this is a criterion that is, this kind of function appear in probability theory, in the study of abstract Markov chains, etc. But the fact that precisely you can build on this homogeneous space setting, you can build function which precisely satisfies these inequalities, really is due to Eskin and Margulis. And this is a wonderful invention. And with Yves Benoit, we were able to go a little further, and I think we could get an almost sure statement. Okay.
This first appeared in the Eskin-Margulis-Moses paper.
So yes, then so there is no random walk in the paper by Eskin-Moses-Margulis. You see the nth convolution power is replaced by the average over a large group, a large ball in the group. Okay, and of course this result itself has an history behind it. For us, it is the point is that once you have that, there is an interpretation in terms of a Markov chain, in terms of a random walk, etc. Also, in the case where you average over a large ball in SLA and R, there is no such a statistic or a dynamical interpretation. So let me go back to the proof of a proposition and 15 minutes now. It turns out to be difficult. I try to be good. So this was proposition A. Assume that mu. Again, so now mu is always a finitely generated, a finitely supported probability measure on SL2Z. And mu is a mu stationary probability measure on T2, which is non-atomic. Then, for almost every b in B, nu b is non-atomic. So, and as I said, this is not a general result. This is, you cannot replace T2 by any space. You have to use a feature that comes from the space, because in case you are looking at the unique stationary measure of the projective line, then the accident, then you know that nu is non-atomic, but the newbies are atomic. So you have to use something which comes from T2. And the, what you have to use is precisely this function. So let me tell it precisely. So this is again an abstract probabilistic result, which I will prove. And this is the following. Assume you have a group G equipped with a probability measure nu, which acts on a space X. And assume there exists. So X is, say, a compact space, a compact metric space. So, and there exists a function, u, which goes from X times X minus the diagonal to 0 infinity, and which has a property that there exists some A which is smaller than 1, some C that is positive, with the property that for any xy, x different from y, when I look at what I now denote by mu u of xy, that is this average here, this is smaller than a u of xy plus, then for any mu on x which is mu stationary, if nu is non-atomic, beta almost every, everywhere, nu b is non-atomic. So what I'm saying is that I have a general criterion for proving this kind of result. I have just to put an input. The input is the existence of such a function on the product space. So what does it mean exactly? Any Let me explain this statement, which is maybe a little obscure. So, as I told you, in case of the projective space, you look at such products, you apply them to nu, and this goes to nu b, which is a Dirac mass. But why it is true? It is true because this is a contraction. So it has a tendency to put everything at the same place. In case you are in the torus, you want p1 bn to be an expansion. So that what you want to have is that you have two points, x and y, which are different. When you apply b1 bn to x and b1 bn to y, they turn out to be far away from each other in most cases. Okay. So precisely this is what you want. You want to start with points which are very close to the diagonal, apply a large product, and see that they are far away from each other. That is, the couple, the pair, sorry, couple is French, the pair BNX, BN, this pair is far away from the diagonal. The points are distinct from each other. And this is precisely what the function tells you. It tells you that when you are close to the diagonal, that is, they are close to infinity in this space X times X minus the diagonal, when you apply on average, you have a tendency to go far away from the diagonal. So, the function quantifies the fact that you act by expansions. So this is the idea that lies behind this, this lemma. And it will precisely work. So let me just, I will prove the lemma, if we are lucky. Let me finish the proof. Let me finish the proof of proposition F from the lemma. Proof, this is the same function. You state u of xy to be 1 over the norm, the distance between, so this is a u1 of xy, because there was a part u, this is a u of x minus y. Okay. So this is exactly, this is the same function, and you just use the you get this property just by the property. This is the same property, because you have this, this is just u of x minus y, and the action is by automorphisms of the group, so there is nothing to prove. Already, I use the same function, okay? So now I just have to prove the lemma.
So on the, I have a question. On the left side, there's u, so on the left side, there's a measure, on the right side, there's a number. I don't understand.
You are lost? Maybe I have lost also, so.
What should be this? Mu, u, x, y is smaller than a, u.
Mu, u, by mu, u, so by mu, u of x, of xy, I mean the integral over g of u of gx. That is, I denote by the same letter, maybe I'm wrong, the action of mu and of the Markov operator associated by mu. Because I'm a little lazy, sorry. Okay, so this is what I mean. Which is, in case the group is discrete, this is just my my sum here. This is this sum here. Okay. So now proof of the lemma. So I will only do a simpler case, but which is in fact the most important one. This is I will prove that if beta almost for beta almost every b, nu b is a Dirac mass. This implies that nu is a Dirac mass. But again, I'm under this assumption here that there exists such a function which separates points. And the general case with spin atomic follows the same lines, but it is a little. I want to have a simple notation. Okay, so what I want to prove is that if nu is not atomic, nu b is non atomic, I will prove that this is one is a Dirac mass, nu is a Dirac mass. So, so suppose nu b is a Dirac mass. I will write nu b as the Dirac mass at some psi of b, where psi goes from b to what? To x, and is a Borel map. As I have the Borel map, I know that it is a continuous, so I put the product topology in b, and I know that my Borel map is continuous on very large subset of B. This is a losing theorem. When you have Borel map, for any epsilon, it is continuous on a set of measures larger than 1 minus epsilon. So I will fix an epsilon.
So it's only four maps in what space?
In what?
I mean, losing is classically only formally for maps from Rn to Rn.
No, 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 for any metric space, no problem there. Exercise. No problem. I'm not cheating there. You didn't see the place I was cheating. Okay. So, what I know is that, so I fix some epsilon, I will fix this value later. So, I know that there exists Y included in B, which is a Borel subset. Such that the measure of B is larger than minus epsilon. And with the following property, that there so let me be careful. I try to be synthetic, but I have to be careful. For any, I will fix epsilon and m, which is very large. And then I will adjust. There exists E, there exists some n, such that for any b and b prime belonging to E, if b1 equals b1 prime. Anyway, it is a very weak sense of Lutin theorem I'm using. And bn equals bn prime, then u of psi of b prime is larger than n. Okay. What I'm saying is that when I take two points which have the same and first coordinate, they are close to each other with respect to the product topology. So necessarily, if they are close to each other, since the restriction of my function psi to E is continuous, their image by psi must be close to each other. But saying that the image by psi are close to each other is precisely saying that the function U is large, since my function U is proper on x times x minus the diagonal. I'm sorry, I will be a little late. Try to be efficient. So, now, I will use a very powerful theorem. This is Chaikin-Einstein-Lagodic theorem. What does it tell me? Here, I have my measure on my space B. Forget about X. And my measure is preserved by the shift map. But the shift map has an adjoint, it is an operator. It has an adjoint operator. So let me define this operator. I define f phi, so if phi is a function on B, I define f phi of B to be the integral over G of phi of GB d mu of G. So what is it? What do I denote by GB? This is just, I have B, and I do the contrary operation to shifting. That is, I add a letter. And a letter, I recall you that B is G to the N. So that adding a letter is taking an element of G. And then I take an average with respect to the measure mu. And if you look at things carefully, if you look at the space F2 of BB, okay. On this space, you've got an isometric operator, which is composition by T, and this is exactly its adjoint operator. This is an operator that preserves the measure. As soon as you have a dynamic that is not invertible, there is something which plays the role of the inverse, that is the adjoint operator. That is an operator, it is not an action of a transformation. You have to make an average of all the inverse branches of the transformation. Okay? And this operator preserves the measure. So since it preserves the measure, I know that for any phi which belongs to L1, for beta almost every bit in B, when I look at 1 over n, the sum, so if I look at Birkhoff sums, but apply where I use the operator instead of a transformation, this converges to the integral of phi d beta. So this is Chaikin-Einstein-Ergodic theorem. This is an extension of Birkhoff's ergodic theorem for measure preserving Markov operators. So I will use this property because you see, here is what's nice. Just from the definition of the new of these, I know that psi of GB is just G of psi of B. So when I apply my operator here, what I see on the other world is just this operator. Okay. On the concrete world of the action, my operator corresponds to this operator. So now I will write things carefully. I will pick B and B prime such that I will assume that my measure is not, my measure nu, which is the image of beta under psi, is not a Dirac mass. This means that I can find in any set of measure 1, I can find B and B prime such that psi of B is different from psi of B prime. Okay. So now I can look at this quantity And where phi is the characteristic function of my set E. And you see, this goes to 1 minus epsilon, at least. So that for n large, so this is larger, for some n large, this is larger than 1 minus 2 epsilon. Okay? So there is this n here, that was an n, I denoted by n. Ah no, I don't have to write there. Sorry, I try to be quick. So, and I can assume I have the same property for B prime here. Okay, so I think I'm done. Now I will compute 1 over n, the sum for k equal n 1 to n of u of mu to the k u of psi of b, psi of b prime. So you see, this is a quantity that behaves exactly this way. And the point is that here, I'm averaging something with respect to a measure. And with respect to a measure, with proportion at least 1 minus 4 epsilon, all the guys, B, the guys I get, fall in this space here, E. Now these are combination of terms of the form dk d1b and dk d1b prime. And they all fall, for with proportion y minus 4 epsilon of them, fall in my space E. And when n is large, okay, they fall in the space E, and they have the same first letters. Okay, same n large first letters. So that the function u on m on them is larger than n. So what I'm saying is that here, this is larger by than n naught over n, because I don't know what happens when n naught is smaller than n, plus 1 minus 4 epsilon times n. Okay? Just because if I look at a world of this form, with probability 1 minus 4 epsilon, it falls in this space E, so that u of the psi, I have to compute a u of of psi. I have to compute something of this form, and since the first letters are the same, this is larger than n. Okay? So this is, maybe this is a minus n not open. So I have a property of this one. On the other hand, you have this property, mu n, mu u, smaller than au plus c. When you iterate it, it's easy to see that you know that mu ku is smaller, this is just summing a geometric series. You have this property. Okay? So that when you look at this sum, this is smaller than 1 over n, the sum from k 1 to n of ak u of psi of b prime, which is finite by assumption because I assumed that psi of b was different from psi of b prime, plus c over y minus n. C is here. And this is just, again, summing a geometric series. So this is just 1 over n, 1 over 1 minus, this is smaller, u of psi of b prime, plus c over, maybe I'm too quick, I'm sorry, but I have to stop. Okay. And this is finite. So when you let n go to infinity, this goes to c over 1 minus n. So when you let n go to infinity, what you get is that this is smaller. And I remember you that epsilon and m were arbitrary. this is where you get a contradiction. So what you know is that you cannot find psi of B different from psi of B prime. So psi is a constant map, and the major is a Dirac mass. Sorry for being late.
Okay, let's thank this Jean-François again and meet again at 5.